Hi, everyone. My name is Josh. I am the owner and operator of Luster Media. Luster is a reboot of a photography company that I had in the early 2000s. And I came back to do creative stuff, provide photo and video for companies and brands. And when COVID hit, I was trying to figure out ways that we can make things special. And everybody's streaming. So I thought it'd be cool to be able to pull together what you see on your screen right now, which is the Luster Art Show. On the screen right now are six fantastic artists. And through tonight, y'all will be able to get to hear and see what they can do. And it's really rad. I think it would be really great, real quick, artists, if you could just introduce yourselves. We can say your name and what you will be doing later in the show. Ty, I'm going to pick on you because you're my brother-in-law, and
sure,
I can do that. Go for it.
Hello, my name is Tyrell Johnson. I'm an author and editor. My book, The Wolves of Winter, came out in 2018 with Scribner and Simon Schuster Canada. I'm here to do a reading of a short story I wrote a while ago, and then hopefully talk some art and creativity in the writing process. So that's me.
Cool. Thanks, Ty. Michael, can I jump over to you? Because on my screen, it makes sense that we would go to you.
Hi, I'm Michael Walton. I am an internationally performing circus artist. Today, I'll be sharing an aerial bungee hoop act with you all and then answering some questions.
Thanks, Michael. Candy, you're up next. And then Thanes after that.
Hey, y'all. My name's Candy. Today, I will be making some art. Nothing in particular. Just going to go for it. See what I can create with the blank canvas.
Yeah. Thanks, Candy. Thane.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right, cool. I'm Thane Yazzi, and I'm an artist and painter as well. But one of my greatest passions, of course, playing guitar. So I'm going to play some music for you guys tonight, do some live looping, and hope you enjoy it. So thank you so much for this opportunity.
Yeah. Thanks, Thane. Makena.
Hi, I'm Makena.
I'm Sophia.
And we're going to be singing some music, a couple of covers, and an original song.
Cool. Okay, artists, y'all can close your or turn off your videos as I enter into this next segment. Thank you all for checking out this space. My hope is that this is something that can happen pretty regularly. I think it's really important for artists to have outlets. And so when we do have these art outlets, I know that oftentimes it can be used as inspiration for other artists who may have found some stagnation with their art. And the nice thing I believe about art is that it, whatever you're working on, it's always waiting for you patiently. I've had experiences where I've played something on the guitar in college and put it away and thought it didn't go anywhere, but it was still there just waiting, and it got rebooted and it grew into something. This show is also a selfish, there's also selfish intent, because there's some stuff that I want to share too. Music has always been a big part of my life, but it's never been one of the forefront artistic outlets. Growing up, I played the drums and I played the guitar and tinkered on the piano. Photography came on strong. And I started my photography business, which is the first iteration of Lester that was known as Josh Stories Photography. But the music came back, and I've got a few songs that I'm really eager to share, but I'm equal parts nervous to share because a ton of reasons. So what I'm going to do now is perform one of the songs for y'all, and in hopes that it kind of sets the tone for the rest of the evening. This song is called Immigrant Song. My family immigrated over from the state, from the Philippines in the 70s. And I was born in Seattle. And yeah, if you are an immigrant or a child of an immigrant, then you know that experience as someone who's experiencing this society for the first time it's a lot. It's a lot, from navigating educational systems to just sort of flying blind in a lot of aspects of life. So this song goes out to any immigrants or children of immigrants out there. And it's a song about really sticking true to what's your truth, and not necessarily assimilating into the majority just because it may be convenient. Sometimes it's harder to stick to your own truth when it may go against the grain. So this is an immigrant song. I kind of view it as perhaps the opening song of a one-man show. I don't know. I'll just put it out there. But I also talk when I'm nervous. So I'm going to stop talking and start playing. Escape what I know. This is not my home. Unlimited potentiality. Folded and twisted into a scheme. Money and text, they both rule the scene. Oh no, this is not my home. So I'll stay in my lane. Please don't search for no complaints. My way against your predetermined grain. This is why I'm staying in my lane. By the sea, submerged into this reality where it's so hard to breathe. So I'll stay in my lane. Please don't search for no complaints. Cause my way was against your predetermined grade. This is why I'm saying, stay in my lane. Next up, our first artist of the night is a painter, and she'll be painting on canvas, and we'll be having a conversation about what she does as we go. So Candy.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm here.
Cool. How are you?
I'm chilling. I'm like ready to get painting.
Yes. Sounds good.
How are you doing? How are you doing?
I'm good. Why don't you start? And perhaps as you go, I can ask you some questions about how you even got started on this painting thing.
Okay.
From the top. Like
from the top.
what's the first memory that you have of painting? And you're like, yeah, okay, this is where we're gonna go.
Very young. I would say like middle school is like where I remember I started painting.
And what were you painting in those times?
It was kind of just random stuff. I really enjoyed graffiti. So I would do like a lot of sketches and drawings of like weird faces and creatures, and started using paint. Didn't take it seriously up until about like college, I would say. High school, college is when it got really serious, and then I've just been doing it since, trying to perfect how I just create things, the lines that I use, the solid colors, and yeah, the message that I want to get across.
And what are some of those themes in terms of messages that you want to get, that you want to come across in your art?
Yeah, a lot of it's just how I interpret the things that are happening in my life. The way that I move through, like in a social aspect. And yeah, it's me trying to be honest, but not voicing with words too much honesty. So I wanna share that in my art and show that with symbols that I use. So a lot of it is the things that I see, my culture, family's culture, culture living in the US. And being a POC. Yeah.
And in the 100%. In these times, COVID times, how have you found has your floor art flowed? And you can go You can go ahead and start.
Yeah, I'm gonna get started. Not really. It's just kind of like a I feel like I've put it aside because I'm working on other stuff. Mm-hmm. But it's still there. Like, there's just art everywhere in my room. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of ideas that I have in here. I keep them in here in my in my thoughts, or draw them in a sketchbook. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What's so your go?
Go ahead.
What is your go-to? I heard it once. I heard an artist talking once, and he said he was reaching the point where he couldn't think of anything to draw. And then in that moment in time, he received his best advice that he had ever gotten as an artist. And that was to draw one thing over and over and over again. And mm-hmm. what he found was he was really perfect. I think he chose this little bird, a bird from New Zealand, and he kind of perfected it. And what he found was that became the character that he used to send messages through. So what simplifying down to one character actually opened up the door for unlimited amounts of things to draw and paint. So circling back, what are some of the objects that you tend to draw that come up often in your drawings?
Yeah, a very common one is faces. But it's just the face, it's not necessarily the body. And it's a face, but it's also morphed with a mask. That's a big one for like the different things that I do. Like, here, I'll show you. So yeah, like I said, like sometimes I have an idea that I want to create, and I'll do the steps that I do to create that image that I have in my mind. But also sometimes I just kind of like let it flow. I'm like, okay, I'm just going to sketch. So I'm going to do that now.
Yes, yes. Yeah.
Generally, it starts with like shapes.
Yes.
This is just a marker that's not working, but it's fine. So yeah, a circle. It's not perfect, it's just a circle. But like when I get into it, like I remember the features of the face, and it's more of I'd say like cartoon characters. But I feel like even then they just start making faces. And when I continue to make faces, the expression changes. So like you can see the eyebrows like a little raised. So I don't know. It may prompt you to emotion when you look at it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I feel like I enjoy doing this because I'm so caught up in trying to make it look perfect. Sometimes like my paintings or just in general my art, like I could spend like hours like working on something, and then I say, okay, this is not finished yet, I'll work on it later. Or I change it. Like I could draw this right now and then later on paint over it because I don't want to continue it, right? But the faces has to do a lot with different emotions that I feel. The different, things that people could relate to, without having a reference. Mm. Like, I'm sure that this that I created, maybe in my life I've come across someone that looks like this, and that's why I made it, right?
Mm.
Or it could just be me, like imagining. Yeah. And
Candy.
Yeah.
Candy, what if What if we circle back to you at the end? So you do this as we bounce through the other artists, and then we can see where you end up in the time. Hold on, I'm having an idea. Okay, this is something that I didn't communicate to everyone when we were talking earlier, but as we record this, I don't see why we can't take it and then we can edit it together and do all those things. So we don't have to be all like, oh, everything needs to be professional. I think it'd be cool to take all this raw data and then pull it together. What I think would be cool is if you and Sophia sang, and then Candy kept on, we kept Candy on.
Yes, absolutely.
Sweet. So hopefully we can get Candy back on.
Yeah, once she's back on, if she wants to just keep creating, that'd be
dope. Okay, Candy. Did you hear our genius plan?
What's up?
You're gonna stay on camera and draw. Makena and Sophia are gonna go through their set, and y'all are gonna be on the screen. I'm gonna hide, and then Mia, you take it away. Y'all are awesome.
All right, cool.
All right, this is fun. I like this. So Sophia's gonna join me on a couple of songs after this one, but this is an original song that I wrote like pre-quarantine, just in a different space of mind entirely, and I still like it. And music has been slow for me this season, so it's good to just go back to an oldie. And then we're gonna sing some covers of songs that really inspire me. So I'm just gonna get started. This one's called King of Nothing.
Uncertainties, my oldest friend, I read beside the window, and he's there on my shoulder as I grow older and older. He is always, always there, but I'm the king, king. I must know something, anything. How disconcerting to feel the sun on my face for the first time, just feeling nothing at all, cause I'm the king, king, king. I must know something, anything. How disconcerting to feel the sun on my face for the first time, just feeling nothing at all. Human, they don't know anything, their fears just multiply and scatter when you try to plot them out or gather. They're just thoughts, perceptions, but then we carved them into weapons. Oh, it's time to be undone. Cause you're the king, king, king. You must know something, anything. How disconcerting to feel the sun on your face for the first time, just knowing nothing at all. Cause you're the king, king, king. You must know something, anything. How disconcerting to feel the sun on your face for the first time, just knowing nothing at all.
Yay! Yay! Woo! 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 That's her uncle.
That's my uncle. All right, I'm gonna bring Sophia on, and we're gonna sing. This next one is from a movie and a musical that I really love, called Once. Sophia, everybody.
Hello.
Hey.
I love this like disembodied voice just coming out of nowhere. It's just super excited.
Yeah.
And what Candy's making is also really cool. I was like getting distracted as I was singing because it's really progressing. It's like becoming something. It's amazing. So yeah, like I said, this is a song called Say It to Me Now from a really great movie and musical called Once. And yeah, we're gonna play it for you. Well, I'm scratching at the surface now, trying hard to work it out, and so much has gone misunderstood, and this mystery only leads to doubt, and I didn't understand when you reached out to take my. So if you have something to say, you better say it now, 'cause this is what you waited for, your chance to even up the score. And as these shadows fall on me, picking up a message, Lord, and I'm closer than I've ever been before. So if you have something to say, say it to me now. Say it to me now.
Yay! Yeah! Yeah!
Our housemates are screaming from the other room. Yeah. I don't think you just heard them.
I love it. Awesome. I feel like the stream got so much better once I got off the screen. Just
well,
like.
I just love this concept in general. I don't know if I've seen it before, but like two live things being created, just like jamming or playing songs, and then someone else painting. Like, I like it. I'll take it.
Ditto. I'm really happy that this is happening, and I'm just sitting back and drinking tea. So I'm going to stop talking.
Yay. It's looking beautiful, Candy. I love that color. It's becoming more dimensional too. But yeah, your starting color was really nice. We have one last song tonight. We're going to play a Brandi Carlile song. a little bit ago, we got the chance to live stream one of Brandi Carlile's concerts, really similar to what's happening now. But obviously, there were like thousands of people tuned in. And she was playing her Give Up the Ghost album. And ever since then, me and my housemates have been just like listening to it constantly and just really enjoying it. It's been like our album in the past couple of months. So we're going to play, what's it called?
Dying Day.
Dying Day.
Yeah.
Dying Day by Brandi Carlile. And yeah, this is our last song. Thanks so much.
Trying to figure out where. Will you fix this if it doesn't scroll the way I want it to?
Yes.
Cool. So it's probably going to have to be slow.
I left home a long, long time ago in a tin can for the road with a suitcase and some songs. Chasing miles through the nighttime, making tracks with no time for looking back to the place where I belong. Oh, these days grow long, but I'm on my way back home. It's been hard to be away. How I miss you, and I just wanna kiss you, and I'm gonna love you till my dying day. Sad, you know, I wish I could be there to make your sorrows disappear and set your troubles free. It's not fair for me to be this far from you, but I promise to stay true wherever I might be. Time keeps burning, the wheels keep on turning. Sometimes I feel I'm wasting my day. While the sound of drunken screams echoes in the night. And I know all of this will come to pass, and I'll be with you at last, forever by your side. Time keeps burning, the wheels keep on turning. Sometimes I feel I'm wasting my days.
I wish I could clap and push the space bar at the same time. This is what I think we'll do. Next up, I believe we have Ty. So Candy and Makena and Sophia, if you could close your videos. Candy, we're going to circle back because I really want to see the end product. Makena and Sophia, you sounded fantastic. Thank you for sharing that with us.
This was fun.
I'm so stoked on all of this. Okay, so long for now. Tyrell, figure out how to turn on your camera and unmute yourself.
I heard the condescension.
Dude, they were so good. I can't wait.
I would buy all y'all's CD. I'm in. That's so good. I feel like we're interrupting a concert for some guy to come up and read some stuff. Like, get off the stage.
Yeah. I can beatbox over top of your reading.
Yes, that would help me. I appreciate that. Thank you.
But you know what? I think that before we even get into that, I think it'd be really cool. Talk to everyone about who you are, what you're doing, what you have out there. A little intro.
Yeah. Well, on top of what I said earlier, I got into writing, I mean, kind of all my life, but it really started becoming something serious probably in college when I got my degree in creative writing, and then I went on to get a master's of fine arts in creative writing and just fell in love with the process of creating story and creating character and creating something that people can enjoy and, you know, escape into and learn something, and, you know, whatever it be, whatever reason you come to a work of fiction, I really enjoy that world and that creative side of my brain that it stimulates. So my book is The Wolves of Winter. I've got one out there along with a couple of short stories here and there and some small magazines. And one of them I'll read tonight. It came out a couple years ago, and you can find it online. Go check it out, or you can find it at your local bookstore and support your local bookstore by buying my book. And that's awesome. My short introduction.
Sweet. I'm gonna hand it to you. You will be reading a short story.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes, indeed.
And then when you're done, I will hoop and holler like I was your Uncle Josh.
Okay, pretend I sang an awesome song and then I'll jump from
my. You want me to stay on? Oh no, I'm
it's up to you, man. Either way.
It's all you.
So I'm gonna read a short story I wrote for an online magazine called Mirror Dance. This was years ago. It's called Water Girl. And the narrator is a female, so you have to pretend this voice that I'm speaking from is not is a female voice, not myself, but there you have it. Okay, I'm just going to go in. It's called Water Girl. Her skin sparkled like silver, a dazzling display of color against the dull fluorescent hospital lights. The doctor pulled her from the water, and she shone so bright she was hard to look at. He snipped the umbilical cord with his white-gloved hands, then passed Elia to me. I held my breath and took her into my arms, both of our bodies half-submerged in the birthing tub. Something was terribly wrong, but no one said a word. As I held the luminescent child against my chest, they all watched the light on her face recede to a dim glimmer. The nurse pulled Elia from the water, dried and swaddled her in a soft blue cloth, and laid her in the hospital crib, which looked like a terrarium for some exotic animal. We all stared like she was about to burst into flame, and it wasn't until the last tiny speck of light faded from her cheek that she began to cry. When I was pregnant, I didn't have any weird sort of cravings, but that didn't stop me from calling John and having him bring me all kinds of things. We weren't together then, but he'd still bring me ice cream, pizza, olives, teriyaki chicken, peanut butter, and pad thai. I hardly ate any of it, and after 9 months, my fridge was so stocked with food, I didn't know what to do with it all. But I was often thirsty. I'd wake up in the middle of the night with my throat dry like leather, and I'd waddle downstairs and drink glass upon glass of water. I never wet the bed or peed myself either, as I've heard happens with some pregnant women. It was like my belly was one giant tub of water. I pressed my hand against my stomach, and when I felt her little kicks, I'd pretend she was swimming. At first, I thought it was some sort of allergic reaction. Perhaps something in the water was irritating her skin. John came to the hospital and sat with me in silence as the doctor tested her blood and dripped little beads of water from a dropper onto her arm. We all watched as the beads sparkled on her skin. Ellie was squirmy at first, so I shushed her and held her tight, but when the water touched her skin, she grew quiet and content. Good Lord, the doctor said, and pulled Elia's glowing arm up to his face. He called the other doctors who left their patients with fevers, infections, heart palpitations, and sexually transmitted diseases to come look at the girl with the diamond skin. They crowded around the room and mumbled excitedly when more drops were administered. I was so upset, I took Ellie and stormed out, in my hospital clothes and everything. They called after me. They said they needed to hold her overnight, that they had more things they could do for her, medicine they could give her, experiments they could run. They pushed their cards at me, but John and I shoved our way through the white coats and double sliding screen doors. A few followed us into the parking lot. Others shouted from their windows as I buckled Elia in John's car and we drove away, the sound of the doctor's jaws snapping after us. Instead of baths, I wiped her down with a damp towel and dried her as quickly as I could. It didn't do a whole lot, and since I lived on the beach, she began to smell like the ocean. When John came to visit, he'd take her outside and rock her on the porch. I'd stand by the screen door and watch the unraveling waves and imagine long, watery arms reaching out for her. He'd sing and I'd listen as he did, thinking that I didn't know he could sing, and that he'd never sang when we were together. When she was three, she dunked her hand in a glass of water. I had left the glass in the middle of the table, like I always do, and she was in her room taking a nap. I had the TV on when I heard her giggling. She had climbed onto the table and dunked her hand into the glass. Her palm lit like a light bulb, then grew translucent, melding with the water as little streams spilled over the edge and gathered into pools on the table. By the time I got to her, I couldn't tell what was water and what was skin. I pulled her off and ran for a rag. Her hand dripped, then slowly came back into focus, then glistened and shone like so many tiny lights before it finally went back to normal. "Tickles, mommy," she said. "I know, honey, but it's bad for you, okay? I like it." Her eyes looked big and sad, and I nodded. "I know, sweetheart." I drank milk from then on. When we were first dating, John would look at me while making love. He'd stare into my face and tell me that he wanted to swim in the blue of my eyes. I told him to jump right in. Toward the end, however, he kept his eyes shut. He'd bite his lip like he was in pain or something, but I still held him close, pressing the skin of my hands to the skin of his back till I could feel his freckles. Open your eyes," I'd think with each motion of his body. The night he broke it off with me, we made love again. I shouldn't have, but he was a nostalgic person, and I thought if I just had him for one more night, he'd remember what we'd meant to each other. We were on the floor with my jeans digging into my shoulder, and I cried as I imagined our skin melting and sticking like glue. He wiped the tears from my cheeks, but didn't say a word. He didn't say a word as he gathered his clothes, as he stood in the hallway for a moment as if remembering something, or trying to forget. And he didn't say a word when I called out his name. He just left, the click of the door handle drowning the empty house. I'm pretty sure that was the night Elia was conceived. I decided to homeschool her, and she seemed fine with it. She liked learning about animals and plants, and she loved to draw. When we finger painted, she would only use blue. So I went out and bought 7 different shades of blue from 3 different stores. Sky blue, ocean blue, royal blue, baby blue, navy blue, denim blue, gray blue. She used all of them. She liked being near the ocean and never really asked about other children. But the first time she saw a family swimming down the beach, she would not stop pestering me to take her for a swim. "You can't, Elle. You're allergic." "I'm not allergic," she'd say. She didn't understand. I had to watch her from the moment she was awake to when we read stories at night. She'd sit on my lap and I'd smell her salty hair. Her favorite book was a children's illustrated version of Moby Dick. "You think the white whale lives in our ocean?" "I don't see why not," I said. "I want to meet him." I looked down at her intent little eyes. "Maybe someday he'll come visit you." "But whales live in the ocean." "That's right. And you live on land, here with me." She nodded as she placed her small fingers on the page and stroked the picture of the giant whale. I suppose I'd seen it coming all along. Perhaps I was even waiting for it to happen. From the moment she was born, I knew she never fully belonged to me. I knew one day she'd be gone. Perhaps it was the fear of it that made me love her so much. When I got up that night for a glass of milk, I saw her through the window. She was standing on the beach in the light of the dilated moon, laughing as the waves made her toes shine like fireflies. I ran. I could hear her giggling even as I screamed. She walked forward into the waves, laughing like she couldn't control herself. The sand gave way under my feet as the water began to bubble and boil with a silver light that surrounded her like a dress. I yelled again, but she didn't even turn as she sunk her head beneath a rolling black wave. Her whole body shone white like the whale, and I could see her radiating even from beneath the surface. It was like on nights when the moon is so bright that it burns a red and black moon spot into your eyes, and no matter where you look, you see its shadow. When I dove into the water, Elia's shining body was gone. I dunked under the surface and scanned the ocean, even though I couldn't see a thing and it stung my eyes terribly. I surfaced, my nightgown clinging to my body like a straitjacket. Elia! Nothing. I swam and screamed and dove and searched until I fell exhausted onto the beach, staring at a night sky scarred with a few dull stars, hiding from the blinding light of the moon. They never found a body, though I knew they wouldn't. They searched, investigated, sent out beyond the lookout notices, but nothing ever turned up. John was devastated, or at least he pretended to be. That's nice of him, I say to myself. That's nice of him at least to pretend. Sometimes I imagine her coming back, washing up on shore and shining like a fallen star. Other times I imagine her with her whale, swimming and giggling and stroking its rough white hide. I drink a gallon of water almost every day now, and I swim. I swim every night, and somehow I feel close to her when I do. I picture the water as her skin clinging to mine, the smell of her on my face, in my hair. She gets in my eyes and it burns, but I hardly mind. Sometimes when I'm feeling extra lonely, I dunk my head a few feet, keep my eyes closed, and fill my mouth with the salty ocean. When my cheeks are about to burst, I imagine absorbing her into myself, carrying her like I did for 9 months. Then I swallow, again and again, until I collapse onto the shore, coughing and spitting and inhaling lungfuls of sweet, life-giving air. The end.
Yay! Can you talk me? There's something really special about hearing you read your stuff, but also having read through Wolves. It opened my eyes to the fact that you have to be so decisive as an artist across the board. But every single line that you chose, there was something different about reading something from someone that I know so well, you know? And I think that one of the questions that I have is, where did this story start? Was it an inkling of an idea? Or did you have it? How did it unfold? Like, can you talk me through the process of the completion of that story, short story?
Yeah. This will be a little hard for me because I wrote it so long ago. So I don't know the beginning inklings of the idea for this story. I can't really remember. I liked speculative fiction. I like fiction that has like a little element of whether it's magic or sci-fi. And in this one, there's obviously a girl who has this weird reaction to water that makes her skin glow. I think that's where it started. And was thinking, you know, what would her life look like? What would her relationship with her mom be like? And it sort of unfolded from there. It's different with writing a novel versus writing a short story. I feel like it's just a totally different beast. And I don't write a lot of short stories, but I do like them. But it's just a different animal. Like you said, you have to be very decisive, especially in a short story, and you have to be very it's like you don't have enough as much room to mess about. Kind of the same thing with poetry. Like each line has to be heavy, like with intent and with meaning, and you have to trim and you have to cut and you have to make every moment count. Especially because you only have this, you know, little limited window of time to get your story across. So I think it started with that. And with short stories, I feel like I can dive into a short story with less of an idea of where I'm going and just kind of feel it out a little bit. With a novel, because it's so long and there's so much involved in it, I feel like I have to have at least more of a mental map of where I'm going. I don't ever like have a really intense outline as some people do, which just, you know, it just totally depends on your process. But for me, I need like at least images in my head of like, okay, I know this is going to happen here and this is going to happen here, and how I get there, I've got no clue, but let's, you know, start putting words on the page and see how we get there.
Yeah. Can I ask about what you have in the works right now?
Yes, you can.
Or is that top secret?
No, it's not. Well, I'm working on another novel. I have a full draft into my agent, and we're just going back and forth with some edits on it, and hopefully we'll be submitting to publishers fairly soon. I'm really excited about it. My agent's really excited about it, and but it's one of those things. It's in the publishing world, things can move crazy fast, and all of a sudden you've got a book deal and your book's coming out, and like, you know, things happen quickly, or you know, it's a slow going process. You're waiting for your agent, or you're waiting for your editors to get back with changes, and then you've got to make changes, and it's kind of this long back and forth. So right now we're in the editing and pause mode before things kick into gear. But yes, I'm working on something new, the next one.
Cool. Ty, thank you for your time. And at the very end, I'm going to ask you all to share where people can find your stuff online.
Awesome.
We'll do that together at the end. Okay. Thane, are you there? Yes. What's up? How do you feel about us having candy up while you do your thing?
That's awesome.
Sweet. Candy, are you there?
Yeah. Yeah, I was just waiting for
this is awesome. Okay, I'm out. Thane, take it away. Candy, keep doing your thing. I'm just going to shut up and yeah, okay, bye.
Thank you.
You were making me make weird faces.
Yeah, so that's just an instrumental original song there. I did all the backing tracks, so it's fun to play for it for you guys. So now it's just going to be straight guitar, no other things going on except for just this guy right here. So again, the art looks amazing. So cool.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And thanks everyone else for sharing earlier. The story was so good and captivating, and the other music, you guys, man, just wonderful stuff. So thank you all, everybody. Here we go. Thank you.
Cool. Yeah. Thank you. So good. Thank you so much, man. Anytime that you go live, I get sucked in, man, because it's amazing to me that you can just free flow for as long as you do. It's really impressive.
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing. Candy, thank you for sharing. I love it. Thanks. Are you going to keep going?
Yeah. I'll have my camera off for the next deck, though.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll circle back at the very end into you. Thanks, Candy.
Sounds good.
Mikel, are you ready? I was wondering if you wanted to set us up.
Oh, introduce myself.
Introduce yourself and let us know what we are about to witness.
Okay. Hi, I'm Mikel again. I'm an aerial artist that currently lives in Boise, Idaho. But I've traveled all over the world doing performances on various aerial apparatuses. And now I'm going to present an act that is pre-recorded, pre-pandemic, but still very close to my heart. It's my aerial bungee hoop act. It's one of the only acts in the world of its kind. I think I'm one of two people that does this particular apparatus. So
okay.
I'm really proud of it. I had to do a lot of research to make it possible because nobody was there to just show me the moves. So I will not hold the suspense any longer.
Sounds great. Here we go.
Thank you.
Josh.
That's so good. I have so many questions for you, but I don't know where to start. I feel like there was a moment where when you were spinning and you were had your leg up here, and I felt like it was just like euphoria for you. Like, is that the greatest feeling? Like, are there moments in there where you're just like, this is the best? Or is it just like, really just like, okay, really plot it out. Like, here's what I need to do.
A little of both. Definitely not euphoria when my leg is behind my head, for sure.
I've never had my leg up there, so I didn't know if it...
No, that's not euphoric, but you make people think it might be. I think the moment in that act that was a little bit euphoric was when I just run around in a circle and my hoop just like bounces me along. That's probably my favorite part.
Yes. Oh my goodness. We were fortunate enough to watch you at VOD of Villingham. And I just remember not being able to like control myself and not like wanting to be sitting, because like what you're doing is just so beyond and the amount of work. Can you talk about like how you got started? Like, you can't just be like, okay, I'm going to do this and boom. Or can you?
The boom is less of a boom and more of a slow, steady climb up a mountain. But
right. How did you get your start?
I started my acrobatic career as a gymnast. I competed as a level 10, and that's the highest level that you can get before you start thinking about going elite or going to the Olympics. So pretty intense training, but not like the Olympian sort of training. Then I took a 5-year break and tried to be an artist of other sorts, because I didn't know that circus existed as a job that you could just have. And one day I walked into a dance class and they were doing a modern dance aerial fabric class for the week. And I was like, oh, this is what I should be doing. And you saw me do aerial fabric at VOD of Villingham. So that's what that is. It's big pieces of fabric that you climb and wrap and drop and twist and spin. And so for those of you that are in the audience that don't know what that is, I sort of just fell in love. And that was 7 years ago. Almost 8 years ago. And I've been doing it almost every day, at least weekly since, except for the pandemic. We had to take a couple months off because our gym was closed. So just going to workshops, learning, teaching myself a little bit how to do all of that.
Yeah. And what other apparatus, you said, what other apparatuses do you perform on?
So I have performed aerial rope, which is just a rope, not like a gym rope. It's covered in a nice covering so it doesn't hurt your body so much. And then I do the aerial hoop, or some people call it the lira. It's made of steel. And then I do the bungee hoop. And I also could perform straps, although I've not performed straps before. And I do a duo act with my partner on straps and adagio on the ground, which is just partner tricks and tumbling on the ground. And then I also have an aerial broomstick act for very special Harry Potter variety shows.
What? I need to let Penelope know that, because she is a big fan. What?
Oh, yeah.
What house do you belong to? I hear that this is the question that you need to know.
If I have to choose one, I'm a Ravenclaw.
Yeah. That's what I did. That's who I am, apparently, because I took a quiz on it. Oh, my goodness. Okay. True. Say it again.
It must be true if you took a quiz.
I think so. Oh, yeah. They're all 100% true. Anyways, your performance was spectacular. I don't have the words to describe. I'm curious, which one of those, what's your preferred, what's your most favorite thing to perform on?
Aerial hoop, for sure.
Cool.
I'm not sure if I like bungee more or not, though.
Yeah, and you were mentioning that the bungee hoop isn't, no one else does that? How did, or it's very rare that people perform on that?
Yeah, There's one other guy that I know that does it in England or Belgium. I think it's England he lives in. He did one act with it and I think hasn't touched it since 2013. So I think currently I'm the only performer in the world that adds on top of her hoop. It just makes it a little bit harder because there's a lot more physics involved. There's the up and down as well as the spinning. And anytime you pull against the hoop, it doesn't necessarily give you the force that you want to like go upside down or do your thing. So it just makes it a little bit more of a strength and cardio challenge.
Wow. And how did you get introduced to it?
The bungee hoop?
Yeah. Yeah.
I made it up myself. So I didn't know that the other guy was doing it before me. I just was like wanting to do something extra in my act. And I just was like, how can I make this different? What would be fun to play with dynamically using different ideas that I've never seen before? And I developed a way to rig my bungee pack to my hoop and actually make the bungee pack. And then just played around on it for 2 years.
Right.
And then made an act out of it. And I debuted that act a year ago. So
okay.
Hopefully it will have a few more miles on it in the future.
So the finale, the head hang, that's a maneuver that's never been done before.
No.
Is what you're saying.
No, oh, no. People will neck hang. Technically, gotcha. It's called a neck hang.
Okay.
As you're hanging from this piece of skin right here.
Yep.
Yeah. People will do that on all sorts of apparatuses. So anywhere that you can find a horizontal shelf to put your neck, you can hang on it.
Okay.
Same goes with elbows, knees, toes, okay. Achilles, shoulders, armpits, everything. Okay. Actually, I've seen people hang from their shoulder blades. So anything
no.
hang by. No.
That's wild. Post-COVID, what are your hopes when things open up again?
As far as this act goes, I was hoping to be able to attend some international festivals with it this year to get into a variety circuit in Europe, because they have a lot of variety shows over there where you create your act and then they buy your act and have you perform it for their season.
Cool.
So I'm hoping that I'll be able to do that with my act. I would also love to create my own contemporary circus company with an all-female cast, because there's a lack of that sort of representation in our industry. So a few things down the road, and maybe do some more international contracts before I get too old, because you can't do this forever.
Awesome. Thank you so much for sharing that and being here and taking the time and putting in all the work to be able to provide that level of awesomeness for us to admire.
Thanks.
Awesome. Thank you. Let's have everyone turn their cameras back on, shall we? I was hoping to go one more round, just real quick. If you could just share how people can find you online and support what you do. We'll close with that. And then maybe we'll do this again sometime. Makena, do you mind leading off with maybe just let us know what websites or what socials you're active on so people can find you.
For sure. Yeah, I'm not super active these days, but you can definitely find some original music. I have like two EPs and a couple of singles on Bandcamp. So just Makena Marie, you can see the spelling in my little box there. So yeah, Bandcamp and Spotify. But yeah, I used to tell people when I played out that they have to just kind of catch me, because I'm not as like into posting online as much as I used to. I prefer to like jam as it happens, you know, like at farmers markets when you could and all that kind of stuff. So I would just say like, gotta catch me. But these days I'm mostly at home. So maybe the answer is more of these live streams. Yeah.
Cool. Thanks, Makena.
You have anything to add?
I have nothing to add.
Thanks, Sophia. Thane, what about you? How can people find you online?
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Cool. I guess my name, Thane Yazzie. I got Facebook and Instagram, all the classics. My band is actually the Stilvetas. There's the name of it. Right. I know people are always like, what do you mean? Or how's it spelled? So that's my band. And we play live stream shows now, obviously. Sometimes when the weather's nice, you'll find us outside on the street. Just keep your ears out. If there's ever loud guitar blaring downtown Bellingham, it's probably us. And awesome. Thank you all so much for sharing too.
Yeah, for real. Thane, will you real quick again spell Stilvetas for me?
Yeah, it's Stilvettas.
Perfect. Thank you, Thane.
Yeah.
Tyrell, how can people find you online?
I'm on Twitter sometimes and Facebook. And you can check out my book. I used to have a website, but I kind of don't anymore. Got Scribner's website or Simon & Schuster Canada's website. They'll probably have links on ordering it, or go to your local bookstore. Either they'll have it, or I'm sure they can order it for you as well. The book is called The Wolves of Winter, and hopefully I'll have another one out to everybody soon.
Perfect. Thanks, Ty.
Mm-hmm.
Candy, how can people reach out to you?
Yeah, so I'm currently I share my art through Instagram, so that's CDILLO_CDO, and it's not super active at the moment, but I usually share on there and do some live painting as well.
Perfect. Thank you, Candy. And Michael.
You can find me on Instagram at lviolet, ELLEVIOLET. And I'll usually post things I'm doing there. You can also support your local circus in Bellingham at the Bellingham Circus Guild and go to their monthly Vada Bellingham. And I've been known to make an appearance there.
Awesome. I'm just tossing these into the chat on Twitch. So one moment. Sweet. Thank you all for taking this time. My hope is that we can do it again, maybe in a month, maybe or something. I don't know. But I'd like to keep this channel active. So if y'all have any ideas, pairing musicians with painters seems like a thing that needs to be happening like on the regular. The Twitch chat has been active. They've been talking about how like chill and peaceful this space has been for them, and I think that's really great. I think Twitch is a funny thing. If I click around Twitch, I get stressed out and I probably wouldn't hang out with most people that are on there. I shouldn't have said that, but I like that we can create a space that's like this. It's a collective of folks that are just trying to share. And I think if that's the main event for any of the streams moving forward, I think we got something good. So thank you all again. I appreciate you all immensely. I'll be in touch with you shortly, and I'd love to hear feedback from all y'all.
Well, thank you, Josh. Thanks for putting it together, man. This was fun.
My pleasure.
So fun.
Cool. I am hovering over the end button unless anybody else has anything to share. We're going to call it a night. Thank you all.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks. Thank you all. Okay. Have a good evening, everyone. Bye.
Bye.